All right, so go ahead, get things started. Earlier, I pasted down just on the inside here a little bit of a like a heavier cardstock, and that's just to ease the transition from the leather to the center here, right? So that my end pages, which I'm going to glue down here shortly, when those are glued down, right, you're not going to fill this big, heavy ridge, that heavy transition between the two. So we're going to go ahead and get ready to glue down actually the end pages here. So I'll probably do that over on the back bench. There's just a little bit I need to clean up here before I go back there. So use my trusty knife and we're going to go for it. Alrighty, so right here, right, like there's just like some parts where it didn't meet up quite properly, so that's okay. I'd rather have it be too close than too far. So I can just come through with this knife, cut away some of that excess, maybe. Maybe. Alright, there we go. Not bad. Okay, so that's feeling a little better there. You got a little bit sticking out right there. So go ahead and shave it down. Okay, and then just a little bit in the corner. I think it was the only other area that I noticed. So get that. Okay, so there we go. So that feels pretty good. Can't really see that super well. But what I'm going to do now is I'm going to take a bone folder and I'll actually kind of push that leather a little bit and I'll kind of roll it over that paper. Again, just kind of helping to smooth that transition a little bit more. But overall, this has been a pretty good project. I definitely found a lot of tools that I still feel like I'm missing. Mostly just better knives, I think. Like, it'd be nice if I had a proper blade for skiving. Still. I know I keep complaining about that. I just need to buy one. That really is just all it comes down to. I just need to buckle down, go online, and purchase myself a nice blade. And stop trying to save a couple bucks by buying inferior blades. Which actually, we had a pretty good day at the market last weekend. So I should have, I think, plenty of money to dole out for a decent knife. So I'll just remove that so you can kind of see what I'm doing. I'm just working on this edge here a little bit. Again, just kind of pressing on that leather, getting it to even out. Gradually ease that transition from the thicker leather to the thinner cardstock that I have in there. And I'll just go ahead and flip it over and do it to the other side, and then we'll be ready to glue these paste downs. I might need to trim this one a little bit more actually. Just on that side. It's hard. You try to line it up as best you can, but the glue is so strong that it just like sticks immediately. So if you don't line it up perfectly as you're laying it down. I just got here What a knife. What kind of knife? A leather knife. Yeah, so the kind of knife that I'm looking at is made by Jeff Peachy. And he's a pretty well-known name among some of the professional bookbinders that I follow. Actually, just about all of them have some type of a Peachy knife. And so that's what kind of blade I'm looking to get. So a leather butting knife. It's called a, well, he has like this hybrid skiver that he uses. So that's what he calls it. So that's what I'm looking to get. Yeah, I'm really excited. I think it's like a $200 blade, something like that. So it's not like the most expensive thing in the world. I just need to man up and purchase it and stop dealing with inferior blades. And like I said, we had a really, really good day at our market this last weekend, so I should have plenty of money to buy that and get more materials and things for the next job. So, yeah, anyways. So yeah, so just rolling that leather. Again, I know that's probably not the best angle for it to be able to see that. But yeah, just pushing the leather in, easing that transition, and then we're going to glue that end page down here in just a second. And you should feel a very, very nice gradual transition from the center of the bookboard here to the leather. So that's the whole point of having a nice skiving blade in the first place, is making it so you can get really, really thin leather here and at the corners. And so that's where I'm struggling actually the most. And you can probably see that pretty well on camera, that there's this discoloration going on right there. And that's because of some of the shortcuts that I have to do to cut those corners down. But if I had a nice skiver, then none of the flesh would be exposed, and it would only be the skin of the leather, and then you wouldn't get that discoloration. So yeah, so that discoloration is coming from the flesh side of the leather poking through. So, you know, just some of those areas where it'd be nice to have the proper tool. And I think at this point, like I said, I just need to fork out the money and get the right tool. It's something that I've had my eye on for a long time anyways, but no, it's pretty cool. So it acts as like a skiving blade and a paring knife kind of in one. So I can both trim at an angle to get my edges nice and smooth down. So that's where it'd be super useful here, right? On the very, very edge of my leather, I can kind of hold it at an angle and cut down. But because there's a curve to the blade as well, I can go right into the middle of my leather and I can thin that out as well. So that's where I've been struggling with my current blade, is that the sharp corners on either side make it so that I can't get any sort of angle to thin my leather, like right in like the middle of the leather. So when I go to trim my corners, I can't get an angle to thin it out. So I'm left with these really, really bulky corners that I have to somehow hide. And so the way I've been doing that has been cutting through the skin into the flesh, and kind of trimming it down that way. So, yeah, not ideal. Okay, so this one doesn't feel like it needs as heavy of a transition as the one on the other side. So I'll go through that really quickly, and then I'll just take it over to the backbench there, and we'll glue those end pages down. But this one's coming together really, really fast. I'm actually kind of amazed at how quickly I can bring these books together now. The first few times I tried to do full hard bindings like this, it just took me, you know, days, weeks actually even. But now pump these out relatively quickly, so. So I guess my only problem now is I just need to find a way to sell what I have so I can make more. Okay, so here we go, there's that. We're gonna jump over to the back desk there. That's my red camera. Go. I like to keep a couple of these papers along with me just to avoid bleed over. So I place it between the colored paper here, so my marble end pages. So I place it right there. And we're going to glue this whole thing down and just place it right like that. So, I'll be using some Linoco PVA. And I'll start by tucking it in the back here. That's kind of the area that I'm most worried about, getting enough glue. But yeah, so today, actually, we should be able to start speckling the cover itself. So I'm actually really excited to get to that stage of the process. Like, we should be able to completely finish this book today. So it's very plain right now, but I think we should be able to get all the way through. So all I'm doing here is taking my bone folder and scraping, getting all those air bubbles out. But yeah, that actually feels really nice. So close it up. And that glue, like I said, will dry like crazy fast. It's pretty nice stuff. I like got all this like paper from a school. Just like all the random worksheets for junior high. So here's somebody's homework, Oliver, I'm presuming. Thank you, Oliver, for doing your homework. So I can use the paper. So, same thing, and start with getting glue all the way tucked back in the back of the corner there. So you can see it's kind of wrinkly, so that's what we're going to take the bone folder for. That's all there is to it. I'll put that there. Let's put a little bit of weight on top. And let it sit for just a few seconds. It doesn't need to sit super long. I'll try to clean all that up. So today what we're going to have to do is we're going to have to take some really good measurements of our book. So yeah, so we're going to take some really good measurements of our book here, and we're going to get the black dye out and a toothbrush. We're going to speckle it, everything. We're going to move on. We're going to do the tooling for this whole thing. And I think we'll do everything except seal the leather itself. So we got a lot to get through. I was watching a guy doing motorcycle saddlebags, and he had a cow leg bone folder. Even left the ball on it. Oh, interesting. So he left like the big knobby part of like the leg bone on it. Huh, that's super interesting. I wonder if you could use those like a handle or something. No, I definitely like this, like the superiority of the genuine bone folders. We're looking at making and putting together some bookbinding kits and taking them to market with us, because we're gonna hit a Christmas market here in a couple weeks, and we definitely want to spring for like the genuine bone folders. So that's kind of the thing, is we want to be able to sell the exact same tools that we use. So we were looking at Teflon folders initially because they were cheaper, but we figured that we would spring for the genuine bone because it is just a little bit better. I don't know. I just don't think you can beat the aspects of the genuine bone. So I really liked it, actually. I have like 4 bone folders, and I feel like I need more. But I've always heard that you can never have too many bone folders. And I think that's definitely true. This one's really cool because it has like a bend to it. I don't know if you can really see that super well. Got to hold it over here. But yeah, it's got like this curve bend to it, which is really cool because I can hold it like this and apply pressure to paper to like fold it and everything. So this one's like super useful for that kind of stuff. But okay. So anyways, like I said, we didn't need to leave this sitting here for too long. just enough to kind of have it set up in shape. And here we go. I don't know if you've like really gotten a good look at how far this has come along yet, but here it is. Here's the progress. I did get these weird wrinkles in my leather, and I think it was because I was using some old parchment paper. I like to kind of keep it wrapped. I use this stuff just to keep it clean. But the old stuff was kind of warped and crinkly. And so when I placed it down, I put some weight on it earlier, like you saw me, just like this. And those wrinkles in the paper ended up transferring over into the leather. So definitely got to be a little bit more careful there. I don't know if you can see it as like the light shines, kind of hits it from the right direction. You can kind of see that. So it's not the end of the world, but it's just one of those things you got to look out for, I guess, right? Be super careful. But I think most of that will be covered up today when we do the speckling. So if you saw the other Frankenstein novel that I did, you probably noticed that that speckling design, we're going to put that on this one as well. So I just got to get some really good accurate measurements here, make sure that my template will fit this perfectly, which isn't super easy because it's rounded on the edges. So, and I got to know exactly like how far back here to the spine I need to go. So if you look at the spine, I've kind of marked, there's a very, very faint transition from the spine, the text block itself, and the book board. And I almost sealed that gap so well that I couldn't find it myself to do these crease marks. So I almost did too good of a job. But nonetheless, they're there, at least enough for me to be able to see and take my measurements. But not as decorative as I was hoping. The other one, I had some really, really nice line work here. But anyway, so that's where I like this bone folder. It has a really, really sharp point on it. And that's what I used to draw those lines initially. So I'll just kind of go over it again. And I did think about kind of hitting it at an angle. So I wonder if I can do that. Get it to appear a little bit more crisply. Bone is beautiful when it's finished, but a pain to work with. If you burn it, it stinks. I've made a knife handles out of it. Oh, okay. Yeah, I'm sure it's it could be finicky stuff. It's really interesting. The more I use it, the more like I see these pores begin to like appear in it. And this one, I got some leather dye on it, but that usually I could probably just rub that right off. But nonetheless, like you can see. Oh, maybe you can't. It's really hard to see. There's like these black spots like from the pores of the bone that weren't there before. So like, I'm not sure if it's just the way that they finish the bone folders when they sell them. But it was like perfectly white, but now you can start to see these little micro imperfections that allow you to know that it's real bone. Like I said, I don't know if they like finish it somehow in some way that you don't see that. And then that finish rubs off or something over time. I'm not exactly sure what's making it so that I can see it now where I couldn't before. Okay, so that's actually working for me fairly well. Just kind of help keep those lines nice and crisp. It was really this side that I was having the biggest issues with because that gap is just so small. I think I kinda... made it so I can't work with it now. I can't tool it quite properly. But yeah, so bone is actually really like super functional. And it lasts like forever. I've had the opportunity to go on a few archaeological excavations, and each time I've gone, we've uncovered a ton, just like a ton of tools that were made from bones. Most of them were deteriorated so much that you couldn't really tell what the initial tool was used for in the first place. But still, it was just very, very versatile. Some people have called it like the plastic of the ancient world, just because it was used like everywhere. Everywhere that we use plastic for now, they would have used bone back then, kind of a thing. But yeah, just a super, super useful material. Yeah, CCL, this, like, right here, right in the middle, is, like, one of those sections where I, like, cannot find where the spine ends and the bookboard begins. So I'm just doing my best. But I'm not really sure how to get those lines to stand out any more prominently. So, I don't know, like I said, maybe I just formed my shoulders too well. Okay, there we go. Let's get some measurements on this, and then I have some cardboard set up over there. So I'll take this whole book with me, transfer it over there, take a camera with me, and I'll show you how that that speckling is done. So, can you give me some cardstock? Doesn't need to be big, but just something that I'll use to make the template from. Perfect. Perfect, so we'll just make it out of this. Grab a ruler. Do you have the square?
Yeah.
Can I use it super fast? I just need to get some measurements.
I don't need it right now,
so. Oh, okay. Yeah, that'll work. Loretta will be back on the back there.
Be a little too far. Anyways, I got some sewing projects going on over here, but I'll be working on this side of the table.
Okay, well, ease what it is. She's working on a quilt, actually. It's a really, really cool quilt. You want to hand me the pattern for it?
I mean, they can kind of see it in that camera there.
Okay, yeah, so there's the pattern for the quilt.
Ooh.
But,
yeah.
Yeah, it's so going to be super, super complicated, but I think it's going to look really, really good.
Yep.
We did a Superman blanket for our son that turned out super great. So.
Yeah, this is based off of Tangled's, the Corona Sun from Tangled. The colors are just really suitable to our daughter, so. Not that she's ever watched Tangled in her life, but. Okay. Brown paper.
So I think we'll do 5 1/4 for the short edge. Just gotta get lined up perfectly on the side as I throw my weights everywhere. Where did I put? Are you taking my rulers?
Taking what?
I don't know. You always take my stuff. It's like part of being married, right? You just, your wife just, or spouse, whomever, just takes all your stuff all the time.
What have I taken? It's the kids that take your stuff more than me.
That's true. Like, if I leave anything on my nightstand, they just walk up and just thief it. I'm like, okay. Have fun with my tie bar, kids. Because it only concerns me when, like, I keep a pocket knife over there, and then they wander off with a pocket knife. Okay, so I'll do 5 1/4. I just gotta measure it down. So we're at about 8 5/8. Yeah, we'll do 8 5/8. Looks good. Good enough for me. Okay, so that's on the half. How do I get 5/8 with a ruler that doesn't mark out 8s?
You have to just use the ruler on the mat.
I think right there.
Or the other square marks 8s, if you want that one. The metal one?
I should be good. I think that... Yeah, there we go. How to handle a knife properly should be learned at a young age. Absolutely. They're a little bit young, though.
I mean, yeah, 2 and 4.
2 and 4. But, no, actually, I mean, my kids, like, have, like, a little, what's the company called? Melissa and Doug tool set thing. And, we try to teach them, like, proper, like, tool safety, I guess, with that. Just a little bit. I mean, you gotta reinforce it in them young, right? Type of a deal. But...
But then the 2-year-old thinks that she can hammer everything.
Yeah, then the 2-year-old takes the hammer again to her brother's face. Classic.
Oh, man.
Classic. That's just what sisters do, right? They beat their brothers. So... It's just the natural order of things. I presume. I never had a sister, but all my friends that had sisters, just seems to be the case. So, I could mark this out, make everything equidistant, but I'm kind of lazy, so I'm just going to do 1-inch borders all the way around, make life simple for me. So I'll mark it out. So the red is just wrapping up our books for to be delivered. So those Aragon books are that we finished up earlier, all done. They just need to be wrapped up so they can be delivered. I made my first sword at 8 with an acetylene torch. I don't know what an acetylene torch is. It was horrible, but you have to start somewhere. Hey, it's true. At 8. That's sweet.
Impressive.
That is. Yeah, I know. Like, I wish I had done more crafty sort of things when I was younger. Kind of didn't. Trying to think of, like, the stuff I was making.
My mom was super crafty. And so when we joined 4-H, our 4-H club was really small. And so she started like a crafting category. And so made all sorts of things.
I forgot you did the 4-H.
Yeah. My sheep. Sheep and crafting.
Sheep and crafting, huh?
Yeah.
Like, you raised a sheep?
I raised a sheep.
Did you eat the sheep?
No, I sold it to somebody else who ate the sheep.
Oh.
That's how 4-H works.
Didn't even get to enjoy the fruits of your own labor, huh?
I got paid for it, though.
It's cool, I guess.
Yeah, so 4-H, you, like, take your animals to auction. You, like, show them off, and then people bid on them. And you get money.
How much did you make? Do you remember?
No, I can't remember. I think I still have my 4-H record somewhere that has the selling price on it. My mother kept everything. It's in that chest my parents brought down.
All unattended children will be given a Red Bull and a plasma cutter. Hell yeah. Sounds like scout camp. Okay, so I marked the corner here. Oh, I don't know if you can see that super well. But yeah, so I marked the corner here so that way I can realign all of these pieces. Once they're cut out, I'll know how to put it back together again. Maybe I'll erase some of the superfluous lines so I can kind of see myself what I'm doing here. Don't get lost in my own line work. Yeah, I have like the craziest stories from scout camp. I don't know if it's just like a normal experience, you know, everybody goes through. There's some crazy stuff at scout camp. There's one time I worked at a scout camp. Actually, I was, like, volunteering there 1 year, so I was pretty young, to, like, really be working there, so I must have been, like, 13, 14. And I was there with a kid that I knew from my hometown, whatever, and, he was, I don't know, he was kind of crazy. But, anyways, so you have to be, like, this troop friend. And that's where, like, you go, you introduce the kids to the camp. So as they're coming in, you receive them, you show them where their campsite is. You kind of tell them, you know, where to find the porta potties and, set up and all that good stuff. And so this kid that I knew from my hometown, he spent a lot of time as his troop friend, or he was this troop's friend, and I was there helping him. So we were out there visiting all the time. There was this kid that was getting really, really close to the squirrel. So it just like lived by their campsite. And he would like constantly like feed it stuff. And so like slowly, progressively throughout the week while they were there, the squirrel kept coming in closer and coming in closer until he could feed it by hand. Like he could just hold something out of his hand and feed the squirrel. So he was doing this one day, kind of coaxing the squirrel out. And the other guys in his troop were playing lacrosse, I guess. They had this lacrosse ball. They're going back and forth, just playing catch. And one of them, I guess, just took the ball and just flung it. So it went flying through the trees. And as this kid was feeding the squirrel out of his hand, the ball comes flying out of left field, pops the squirrel right in the head, kills it instantly. So...
So, all the luck in the world.
Yeah, so this kid's like super sad. Whatever. And that's when I show up on the scene. So I'm just walking, right? Walking by. And I see this kid crying. So and I knew him because I was helping out his troop friend. So I went over there and I'm talking to him and I'm trying to get the story straight. And he tells me, you know, what happens to the crossball coming in, killing the squirrel. And I was like, okay, well, where's the squirrel now? And he's like, well, the kid that you knew growing up, I don't want to use his name, I don't know, what should we call him, we'll just call him Bob. So Bob, this kid again, that I went to go work with, he was over on the side of this kid's tent with the squirrel carcass, and he is skinning it in front of all of the other boys, and he's taking the skin and pegging it to a board to take it so he can go in and tan it later. And the kid's just bawling, and I'm like coming across the scene like, what the hell do you think you're doing? And he's like, well, he wasn't going to use the squirrel not for anything. And I was like, oh my gosh, you can't just like skin the squirrel in front of the kid who was trying to make it his friend. I don't know. Just out of control. But,
gracious.
I don't know. That's just a normal day at scout camp, I guess, right? Really. Happens sometimes. Make friends with a squirrel. Some other kid comes along and skins it right in front of you.
Oh, wow. That's a thing.
One man's pet is another man's...
dinner?
I guess so. Science experiment.
Science. Okay, Peter.
Yeah, this thing like flayed out. He's dissecting it. Here's the lungs, kids. They're all crying.
Squirrel is tasty, a bit on the nutty side.
Yeah, I've been fed squirrel twice. And I will say, it's actually not too bad. When I lived in New York, I had a couple people feed me squirrel. So good, didn't happen once, happened twice. What is the project this week? That's a good question. So, we are working on another Frankenstein book. So I'm just trying to kind of refine the processes that I did the first time. So the first time was kind of an experiment, trying to get the processes down, figure out like the decoration techniques and everything. And so this time, we're just, like I said, trying to refine it. So it gets to be a little better. And then Loretta is going to be...
over here.
Yeah, she's over there. She will hopefully have our... Christmas ornament done. So we just needed to finish the template on that one, get it printed out, and we're gonna make some mini books that can be hung on a tree. So I want to be able to make a few that I could actually take to like a Christmas market. I don't know how well they'll sell, but I know that a lot of people really, really love mini books. So that's gonna be kind of a challenge in and of itself. We gotta find a way that we can replicate the process for creating this ornament. But replicate in a way that it's not going to cost me, like, you know, $50 worth of my time, in order to create. So that way I can actually sell it at, like, a profit and not just waste all my time on it. So we're kind of going over different, binding styles, some kind of spitballing different ideas, things we can do there. And then beyond that, we will hopefully be starting a Pride and Prejudice project this week as well. I guess upcoming week, now that we're kind of at the weekend. So, yeah. So those are the kind of things that we'll be up to. Today.
I don't know how loud and crinkly that paper is, but it's loud to me.
Yeah, like I said, she's just wrapping those books up on the back bench there. But then she'll probably come over here, and I think you're going to work on that formatting most of the night, right? You said?
Yeah.
Okay. So, yeah, so she'll be working on that formatting, so that way we can hopefully start on that. But today, for this stuff, I think I should be able to finish up this entire book today. So, I did have a little bit of a meander there. Hope that won't... Well, it shouldn't show up. It's just speckling, so it doesn't need to be, like, super precise. At the end of the day, I'm just flinging dye at it. But anyway, so yeah, so you can see that I'm just doing, like, these concentric rectangles. And that's what's going to serve as kind of the guard, the guide for the speckling process. You know, we have bigger scissors than your little free Cricut one.
You know, I didn't want to walk all the way around the table to get them. That's where I'm at today.
Fair, I guess.
It cuts.
So yeah, so pretty easy actually what we're doing here. I'll show you now that I got it all cut out. And so like I said, that's why I marked the corner with that little slash mark there. But what we'll do is I will remove the outer one first. So it'll be like that, and then I'll speckle the book with like a light sort of speckling. Then I just place this back and remove the center. Like so. And then we'll do a very, very heavy speckling in the center that will almost basically turn this entire rectangle black. So that's how that's gonna work. So what I gotta do, I have some cardboard just sitting on the ground over there that I'm gonna use to catch all the flying ink that's gonna get everywhere. But I'm gonna set that up now so that we can speckle.
Dave says a template and a mask all in one. Neat.
I'll just take some of Jimmy's homework and use that to kind of protect the text block a little bit. That stuff is super
low. I know, I'm sorry. It's pretty thick craft paper. It's probably too thick for the purposes I'm trying to use it for, but it gives it a really... It's like a brown paper package. Tied up with almost string.
We've got some Angela's jet black dye.
Angela's.
Whatever you want to call it.
Whatever the kids are calling it these days.
Don't hate me if you're German.
Is it German?
I don't know.
It started in California.
Well, doesn't mean it's not German.
It's true.
Most white people in America came from somewhere in Europe.
This is true.
I need... a rock. Where did I put those rocks?
Probably took it back outside to the garden.
Probably did. Here, I'll just flip it over to you.
Oh, well, you can't really see what I'm doing, but...
Okay, I just gotta go grab a rock.
Hidey-ho, hey.
From the garden.
So, you guys, I have three of the four. I know, it's kind of hard to see. That camera's a little far away. So you can see my mess of my quilting project and everything else. But, one more book to wrap. And then, yeah. So, that's what I'm up to over here.
Check it out. Found some rocks.
Rocks. Sweet.
Elf people of North America. Yay. Go. Like I said, I'm going to be removing this outer layer first. And I'll place my rocks. Here, check the center so it doesn't shift and slide. And I guess more importantly, so that no dye gets underneath. Set that to the side. Of course. Should always wear gloves when handling dye in the first place, but today I'm doing that. Definitely using a lot of my fingers.
Baker Robert says, what? And miss the opportunity to walk around with Black Angelus Black, or with Angelus Black stained fingertips for 3 days?
Done that before.
Have done that before. Always. It's usually when he's doing his lighter color dyes that he forgets to wear gloves.
Forgets a strong word. Laziness is,
Laziness.
How about I forget? Thank you.
Okay, there we go.
That's it for just a second. Let me flip it over. But yeah, I've definitely gotten black stuff on my hands before. So very nice. Yeah, so I'm really excited. Like I said, we're going to be doing a Pride and Prejudice project here. So I guess we'll see how long this one takes us to do. The first Frankenstein was really experimental, and we did that in
2 weeks.
2 weeks total.
Yeah, I think it was only 2 weeks.
Okay. I feel like that's really long. I thought we did it in a shorter time than that. So this one though, this Frankenstein, I think has taken us only a week really to get to this point, which. For like active work time is only like 3 days, so we're now that we're getting familiar with and comfortable with the steps and the process that it takes to get to here, we can get through our production a lot faster. So that's really really cool. So anyway, so Loretta is working at the computer, just doing the. Our little Christmas ornament.
Yes.
I don't know if you want to show them that one or not.
Yeah, let me just get everything pulled up here for a minute.
The black is not so bad. The dark brown.
The dark brown is disturbing.
Yeah.
So, over here I've got... So you can see the file here. So it's all, so each one of these that you see on the screen is a page. About two by three inches, just less than. This page will be cut in half, or cut into quarters and then folded so that there's 8 pages per signature. And I was struggling because I had to reformat the margins. I needed more space around it for cutting or for trimming the text block. And so I've been shuffling things around, and I just figured out a tool to move the text from one block to another so it like bleeds over. So that's why I figured out at the end of last stream. And it is going to save me a bunch of time. So, that's what I'm working on today.
You can put it back here if you'd like. Just going to set up for side 2. That dye, like I said, just dries so fast. Which is nice, because yeah, it allows us to... Yeah, you know, walking around with like brown fingers, like you said, it's not too bad.
Most people won't bat an eye at it, but. Oh, you don't think the black is too bad? I guess so. I guess that kind of makes sense. Because if you like walk around with like brown fingers, then it kind of looks like sickly, I guess. I don't know.
But I could see that too. Thank you. phase one complete. Initiating phase two.
Speckling just looks so good.
I definitely think it adds like a lot of character to the book. It goes from being so flat, two-dimensional, to like looking nice, refined.
Data says it dries that quick. I thought it was a minimum of 4 hours.
Well, it dries enough that it's not going to smear. So
I don't know. I haven't seen it. Like, haven't had any issues. But I'm also not really rubbing it a lot, so I'm sure, like, if I were to, like, to take it immediately afterwards and, like, try and, like, brush it or something, that I'd probably have issues. But it's at least dried enough that I can flip it over and not worry about, like I said, smearing it everywhere, getting it super messy. So, but yeah, I'm just going to let that sit for a couple minutes. I just wait until it's no longer glossy. I no longer see that shiny surface on it. And then that allows me to transport. But I'm also transporting it on the parchment paper that you saw. So I put that parchment paper underneath. Again, just to be super delicate with it, because I don't want to get stuff on it or accidentally scratch it. Once I put the sealant on it, then that kind of adds a protective coating, so I won't worry about it as much. But until the whole thing is sealed, I try to be super delicate with it. So I'll send you over to Loretta, clean up my mess here real quick.
I'm just still trying to find the file that I lost. So, we'll see. It might be in... I'm gonna check one more location to see if I can find this file that I'm missing. I had like a master file that I had edited all the text for the for our ornament in before I put it into Publisher, and I can't find that master document, so I'll have to look one more spot.
All set up over here. Camera. Sorry. So hopefully that's a decent enough angle on there. So it just needs a few more seconds. And then I'll place this template back on it.
And we're gonna start marking our lines, so. That's gonna be used for. What's that?
Red.
Yes. So this first one here, it's kind of goobery. I need to clean it up. So keeping stacks of napkins around is like super useful. I used to like keep paper towels, but I didn't always have like a free hand to like rip it off the roll. So I just started keeping like a free stack of napkins instead, and that is great.
Oh, well, there it is.
It's like if you like knock over like a glue jar, which I've definitely never done before. You can just reach over really fast and grab a napkin and clean it up.
Oh, good, I found it. I found it. This would make my life a little easier.
Okay.
Let's go back here.
Go, the first line is created.
Data, I bought a whole snake skin because I wanted to redo the leather wrap on my bow, but they only had red and black snake skin pre-made wraps, and that would never do.
What color were you going for? Sounds like you had a much more specific color in mind. Or were you just hoping for like a natural that you could color yourself?
Whites and black. Or white and black.
Oh, white and black.
Yeah, I remember on chat the other day when I was painting Eldest, you said you weren't a big fan of red and black.
Oh, that's right.
White and black, though, that'd be sweet.
You must not be a true gamer.
True gamer.
Go. Just got those edge lines done. Anyway,
So I'm gonna wait to do this line. I really struggled getting that straight line the last time, so I don't know, I'm wondering if I just don't even put a line on that side.
Yeah, I'm not sure.
Okay, we'll take this one. This one's a little bit thinner. And I need to clean off this surface a little bit. So white and black bow skin wrap, huh? Is that like a recurve bow that you were working on, or? Guy here in Utah who does, what is it, Primitive Crafts? I think is what his Instagram handle is.
Mm-hmm.
And he does all sorts of like really, really cool
things. Yeah, his stuff is pretty fun.
Yeah, but he'll do like a lot of Native American inspired type of artwork and stuff. And so I've seen him do different things for like bow handles. He does a lot of like weaponry, again, like kind of Native American inspired.
A violin bow.
Oh, I was way off.
Oh man.
Violin bow can be used as a weapon too, so maybe we're not totally off. I didn't realize people got their violin bows wrapped like that.
Bank and robbers, you aren't the only one.
Sorry, I'm right-handed, so is that a better angle on that?
I can't even see your head's clean.
Does that look good? If I do it from this side? So you can kind of see the tooling do its work rather than just see my hands getting in the way. I think this just really helps to like sharpen the lines a little bit. Distinct lines, but okay, so that's where I like to use this sharp bone folder just to kind of get the various most edge of that line work. Although actually that's not working too great. Thank you.
data, lol. I like the other bows as well, but it's a pain to play a violin with a recurve bow. Banker Roberts, if you live in an area with snakes of sufficient size, there is a book on tanning that has a section on snake skin. Name of the book is Tan Your Hide.
Oh, interesting. That would definitely be like a, I think, a fun craft to get into, to like know how to tan hide and stuff better. I think snakes are actually pretty rare in Utah nowadays, though. So I wonder if you'd get in trouble if you tried to kill a snake. I'm pretty sure a lot of species are on the endangered list now. So yeah, I think I'd actually get into a lot of trouble if I tried to kill and tan a snake. Maybe down in like Arizona though or something. Instead of my rulers.
When I first saw salmon leather, I watched how to tan your own, but it's a pain. It's dirty, messy, and I can get them for $2. Snake of any color for $12, so I'm good, lol.
Yeah, this is like the best part in my opinion.
Oh, those diagonals?
Just doing these diagonal lines. The character of the whole book.
Oh yeah, they're so fun.
Actually put that there and graph
the square.
Do I have any the scraps lying around? Listen, there it is. No.
Just so that way I don't accidentally go over. Yeah, there we go, that's better. So while I was living in New York too, and I guess I should clarify, too, that I was in Western New York, so I wasn't anywhere close to the city. That's why the hillbillies there were feeding me squirrel. Not something I think you'd find in the cities, per se, that type of cuisine. But, anyways, while I was there, I had a gentleman who was teaching me how to skin and properly prepare raccoons for the tanning process. And I remember that was pretty crazy just in and of itself. That was like a lot of work. So there we go. And like I said, I think those like corner lines just really add just, you know, that much more character to the book itself. Looks really nice. So I like to do that. And then I just take this simple little floral stamp that I had that came in like one of those cheap, crappy leather working tool kits. It's actually been super useful because I'll just put that little leaf flower thing up here in the corner, kind of top it off. And this tool might need to be heated up, actually.
I thought that's what you were going to try and do.
That didn't work
time.
Super great. So I'll do that later. We'll try to hot tool that leaf into the corners. That worked super good the first time, but not so great this time, so that's good. Move on, do the back side, and then we just have some like spine decorations. I might hot tool the spine as well if that using that flower one works really good. Yeah, I have no idea how that's gonna go. I've never hot tooled leather before.
Yeah, I mean, if you do hot tool, I would do it on a practice piece, see how the temperature works. Don't ruin your book.
No, it's fine. Caution to the wind, I always say.
Always.
Best and fastest way to figure out you're doing something the wrong way is to make a horrible, irreparable mistake. What you doing now?
So it linked to the wrong box.
Okay.
And so now I need to. Figure out how to unlink it and what that is going to do. I accidentally linked it to the wrong one. So now all the pages are off. Again. Oh, formatting books is so much fun.
Yeah, so the reason why Loretta is struggling so much is because you have to line up the pages in a way so that when everything is folded together, everything's like the right side up. All the page numbers wind up in the right place. And there isn't really like a program
to help
you do that, unless I think Adobe does it, right?
I haven't used InDesign, but I think it might work. But we just have like a regular printer. Like, we don't have an offset printer. And offset printers do this. So.
Offset printers do what?
They allow like folding of signatures in like multiple directions.
Why is it the printer that controls that?
Well, it's not, it's like the program, but so the program, so like the big offset printers are like the big like indigos and stuff.
Right.
So they can print on super large sheets of paper that get folded and then cut.
Right.
And so, just because we have a regular printer, I don't know, I haven't used InDesign, but I think it might be able to overcome the problems that I'm having. But yeah, so this template here, so it's been folded and unfolded many a time. And so, I just have the page numbers on it where they need to be, so that I know where they are on my document. So, Dave says, to cook a loon, you get a big pot, fill it with water, and put a good-sized rock in the bottom. You put the loon in and boil it for 2 days, then serve the rock because it'll be more tender than the loon. Man.
It's one sound I've always wanted to hear.
Yo, Nuthead, what's up?
Hey, Loretta, just finished wrapping your books up for you.
Yes, your books are all wrapped, and I can deliver them tomorrow. There's a time that works for you. Okay, so. If I click. What's gonna happen? Is it gonna unlink the one before or the one after?
Yeah, the worst thing that could happen is you lose all your progress and have to start completely over.
No, I think it worked. Whoa, new angles, yes. Yeah. Whenever we go to market, we have to take down tables, and when we put them back up, things just get moved around. But I have a lot of computer work to do, so that's what this camera is, and that's what I'm working on. And then we have hooked up all of our cameras wirelessly so that they can just be moved all around the room, whichever direction.
Yeah, which is super nice. You missed it earlier, but I was able to like just pick it up, put it on the floor to do the dye speckling for this book that I have right here. But yeah, that was super nice. You also missed one of my scout camp stories.
Okay, that works. Let's go to the next one then. 17.
last one, and then we'll just do a few lines on the spine, and I think we're done with this tool. And the rest of it will just be that hot tooling once I figure out how I'm going to do that. Okay, but there you go. So, looks pretty much done.
Data, I spent most of the day switching everything on Wi-Fi from the old internet to the new. What a pain in the bahookie. We did that about a month ago. It's a pain. Because we have so many smart devices, too. And they just... Ugh. It was bad.
So yeah, so there we go. That's, like I said, it's pretty much done.
Goodness, that is looking beautiful.
Like I said, I just need to do the hot tooling there in the corners.
Heavy, that looks fantastic.
Well, thanks.
How are you doing, Heavy?
Yeah, how's it going, Heavy?
Headache, but I'll get over it, LOL.
Well, good. Glad to hear you're doing well. Aside from the headache, of course. Okay. So I think I'll do is try to do, at least, to get this line right here. This is the hardest one because I'm really going to have this angle line. So that way the book feels more balanced with that line on the outside there. Okay, I'll do that to the other side.
But I figured out how to fix it and it's not gonna like ruin everything. So that's good.
But no, I'm really honestly super happy with like how this project has turned out. I had so many worries, I guess, going into it. Probably because I've like ran into so many roadblocks in the past. But this was really not bad. Not bad at all. So I'll just make sure those lines meet up completely in the corners, all I'm doing right now. Make sure those extend all the way down. Definitely need an acrylic finish.
Yeah, probably.
To finish this out, just to give it that layer of protection. Seal everything in. Give it that scratch resistance.
So I have 6 signatures for you.
6? Okay, that's way better than it was before.
So I'm just working on formatting a tiny book.
So what we did is we took the Christmas story and we like condensed it down into like a single tiny book.
Yeah, so we took the Christmas story from the 4 Gospels and got it all kind of formatted here. So each of these four pages, each of these rectangles are a page. It's about 2x3, really tiny. And so each of these 4 corners are going to be a signature, and And so some of them are, you can see the text is upside down. And then when it's printed front back and cut and folded, it should be a book. And so, yeah, so 1, 2, 3, 4, and then 5 and 6. So there's the back to that one. So I've got 2 blank signatures down here, and then the last 2 pages and the last signature are blank, just because of the text. Because put it all together, it's not very big. But I might shrink my margins again. Actually, give it a bigger margin. I have some more editing to do in here. But at least I figured out how to format the book to where I can edit it very well. So, that is what I'm working on. And that's back on you on that back camera.
Oh, okay. Hopefully that's not like too tall.
Dave says, I use Waver Tough Coat because I got a big jug of it and it's pricey.
Weaver Tough Coat, huh? How much is that?
Can you look that up? That sounds interesting. Is it like an acrylic finish or something?
Yep. Weaver Tough Coat?
Yeah, that's what I said. Looks like it's tough, like T-U-F-F. $17?
Like, that's not bad.
K-O-T?
Yeah, put that in our cart. Let's get that.
Do they have it on the Amazon?
Probably, and it's probably cheaper. Okay, so here, somebody explain to me. I want to know how this makes sense. Why is it that companies will sell stuff on Amazon for less than they sell it on their own websites? Like, I mean, I really don't want to be the person who's, like, giving all of this patronage to Amazon. But it's really hard when, like I said, companies will sell it for less on Amazon than they will on their own websites.
Oh, I spelled that wrong.
T-U-F-F. T-U-F-F.
It's T-U-F-F and then K-O-T.
Yep.
English.
English! Do you speak it? There you go.
No, we're trying to...
So there you go. So I guess in this instance, it's at least cheaper on Weaver's website.
That's true. For court. Used for top and edge finish on Carnish-Strut bridle and skirting leathers. I'm in Canada, so it's pricier for me, lol. Yeah, that dollar's not too hot.
Yeah, I'm like tempted to start trading on the ruble. The only currency in the world that's doing good.
Okay.
At least we're not in Europe, right?
So the real question is, how much is shipping from Weaver? Because that's... I mean, we have Prime, but sometimes it's cheaper to just pay for shipping. It's sold in pints or gallons. Here's the quart. So the quart is cheaper on Amazon.
See? So I'm saying.
It's crazy. Why? Craziness.
Why do companies do this? themselves.
Important shipping information below. Where is shipping? Where is said shipping information? Item cannot be shipped when temperature is below freezing.
Okay, we'll order pass.
Right. Heavy says FBA. FBA. All capitals. Amazon has cheapest freights / shipping. Cheaper than fulfillment by merchant? That makes sense. It's because they've got such a wide network. Picture on Amazon looks older, like an older model, but that shouldn't be an issue. Okay. Now, I would check out, but I have all this other stuff in my cart. For possible bookbinding kits.
Yeah, and I think I explained earlier that we were looking at.
Oh yeah, I missed the first part of the stream, so I don't know what you were talking about earlier.
So.
Bank and Robbers. Amazon has a shipping center in every major city and has regular routes between warehouses. Hard to compete. Heavy agrees.
I don't know. I try to be a conscious consumer as much as I can. So, pains me that I use Amazon as much as I do, but.
I would much rather have somebody buy my product than a product off of Amazon. But yeah, those shipping prices.
Okay, so a couple of things that we might do with this book still is, like I said, I might hot tool the spine. So I have a kind of this four corner, I don't know what you call it, leaf looking pattern thing. So if I can get the hot tooling down properly, then I'll put one of those in the center here of each of these, except one of them will leave for a black tag, so we can have give credit to Mary Shelley, of course,
tilt that
for her work.
Camera off just a little bit.
And yeah, so those are like the two other things that we might do with this that I probably won't get to tonight. So for tonight,
yeah,
this book is done.
So Bacon Robert says, I'd rather give to a smaller business than Jeff Bezos, but there aren't any good options near me. I think the closest bookbinding supply house is four states away. Same. We don't, I mean, not quite that far, but Tandy Leather does not have, like, good bookbinding leather.
Yeah.
Heavy. Yeah, but we all like using their Twitch.
Ooh.
Yeah.
Yeah, true. Very true.
Frog jelly.
Okay, here we go. So, flip that over. As per Nochit. So, I like I said, I'm amazed that these are coming together as well as they are. Mm-hmm. I think, I was mentioning earlier, I was talking with Data, that I just need to buy a peachy knife. So, do you want to just put in an order for that? Let's just do it. Get that A2 hybrid, and maybe pull it up on the screen share so they can kind of see what that looks like. Because the blade itself is kind of hard to describe. But they look really, really nice, and I've seen other just bookbinders in the business. They all seem to be using those peachy blades. So he's definitely like the name in bookbinding skiving blades. But that's the only thing that I think I'm really missing is
as I make these books, is getting that nice skiver so that I can do these corners better.
Yeah, so here's this hybrid paring knife. And so it's very much like an English, but it has that rounded edge on it.
So yeah, so scroll up. So you see right there, he can cut like an English paring knife on like the diagonal where he can thin out just the very, very edge of the leather and then scroll up. And then he can use the rounded part of the blade to thin out the leather in like the middle, right? Like he can start right in the middle of the leather, go out towards the edge and still skive it in that direction as well. My skiver has a sharp point on both sides. It's a very square blade, and so the corners of my blade will just get cut in the leather and it just rips right through. But that one, because it's rounded,
so it's just used for the scooping action, which is, if you read here, spine, head caps, and decorative work, which is exactly what we need it for. And and what we're struggling with skiving is the decorative tags and things. Bang Robert says Frog Jelly has veg tanned calf sides for $50.
Who is that?
Frog Jelly. I've never heard of them. Yeah, Heavy, best to not skimp on tools when you can help it. Sure.
A good tool is definitely an investment. So, do green. So yeah, so like I said, the corners are the only things I'm struggling with. Try to center it. And so you see that discoloration. I was explaining that earlier. And what that is it's where it's the flesh side of the leather. So, unfortunately, because I don't have a really, really good way of thinning down that leather, normally all you want is the skin side of the leather to be showing, so it has, like, that consistent coloration all the way through, but, I can't thin out that well. So, the flesh side of the leather is exposed, and that's what's giving these, dark-looking corners. I don't know if you can really see that super well on stream, but that's the only... like significant blemish, and you can kind of see too that it puckers in a very undesirable way because I'm not able to thin out the leather as much as I would like to on the corners. So that's one area where I'm struggling. Other than that, like the text block came together beautifully. It's really hard to center on that camera for some reason.
You can just probably zoom out a little bit.
I don't know. I'm not sure if it's that or if it's like shifted left or right. But like the speckling turned out really, really good. I don't know if you can see that sort of detail on the
spine or the edges
on the stream. This double layer French headband turned out super good. The shoulders on this were just like incredible. Just makes for a very, very solid book. But yeah, so that's pretty much it for that. And eventually, you know, I think I'll get some proper tools for doing the actual decorations on the cover designs and stuff. But for now, the stuff that I have is working. At least it gets the job done. But anyways, I'm just excited. It's really, I think, taken a long time, several months, for me to be able to get to the point where I feel like I can produce books of this quality. But I mean, it works really, really well. That spine has some good flex to it.
Work there.
Well, thank you. And that Linoco glue is just really doing its job. But yeah, that spine has some awesome flex to it, and then it just snaps back to that perfect shape. So, which is cool because the leather here is glued directly onto the spine itself, in like a more traditional, like medieval type binding. So. That and Loretta did a fantastic job with the marbling on these. It looks very professional.
I love those traditional colors.
So.
Heavy, it took me a long time to quit arguing with myself about tools. I kept shooting myself in the foot for many years.
Yeah, and that's where I'm like, I'm done. I just need to buy the stupid knife. So.
And here it is. I'm checking out. So.
Hey, so, yeah, I'm really glad. But it's great because, like I said, we had a really, really good market day. This last weekend, so Tatum 44. Well, awesome, awesome.
Welcome in.
Yeah, welcome Raiders. Yeah, I guess I'll say that. What was I even talking about? Tools, something about tools.
Fine work.
fine work. I don't know. Welcome in, Raiders. Welcome in. So we're right here. We're working on a... let me center that a little bit better. I think it's because it's flipped upside down. So, like, that's everything's, like, mirrored. But, welcome in, welcome in. So, here I was working on a Frankenstein book. And I was just doing, well, pretty much all the final touches on it. I got the speckling done today. So, that's where you see all the dye speckles there. And then we added in all of those, the line work, I guess. Not as good as like what a proper brass rolling wheel would have done, but it still did a really, really good job. Mm-hmm. But if this is your first time here, I'm a bookbinder, primarily is what we do on this stream. Occasionally I'll do other stuff with leather and whatnot. But Tatum, how's it going? What brings you in tonight? What were you doing?
Yeah, how'd your stream go? What were you working on?
Are you a fellow crafter?
I'm
assuming so, since Chevy Guy seemed to be hanging out in your chat.
I lurk in the Craftsman's Guild Discord, so I do know Tatum is...
Oh, okay.
Part of the Craftsman's Guild. Aw, thanks for that gifted sub, Knothead.
Yeah, thank you so much.
Making a top hat out of beer cartons.
Huh. Right. Okay. Interesting. So what does Tatum usually do? I guess you've been over there.
I know. I lurk on the Discord. I'm not very good at chatting.
We're trying to be better, more participate more in the community.
He fishes a lot, I think.
He what?
He fishes. He does like, he live streams when he goes fishing.
Oh, okay.
That's what I've seen recently. Correct me if I'm wrong, Tatum. But that's what I've seen recently.
Okay, well that's sweet.
And you do, I know you do like other crafting things, but I think it's been, anyways.
Yeah, that's way cool. I guess if you have any like pictures of your work or anything like that, then you can feel free to post that in the chat. We have links open and everything. So we love to show off other people's work here. I know people have done it for me before, and so I love to pay that forward, and we love to look at other people's work. So like I said, if you haven't been here before, Bookbinder, this project here has been really, really fun to get to this point. It's been several months of me prototyping and building those skills and everything. And so this is kind of a culmination of all the skills that I've been building up over the summer to get to the point where I can bind a book like this. So definitely has some imperfections going on that I was talking about earlier. But with the tools that I have and everything, I think it's turning out really, really good. Tatum is a professional peach pit carver. What?
An Etch-a-Sketch artist.
An Etch-a-Sketch artist. Nice. That's way cool.
That's so fun.
But, So all this we made from the ground up. So this is Frankenstein. Flip it to the title page there. So we printed it out ourselves. And then I made the end papers. Loretta did the marbling here for that. And I don't know. It's just turned out really, really well. I got the French headbands there that I'm really, really proud of. Learned to do this week, or I guess last week. So, there we go.
TW, his Etch-a-Sketch skills are mine. I mean, that's a skill, I would say.
Yeah, that is true.
I'm over here on the computer. I am working on formatting our tiny book for the Craftsman's Guild Community Challenge Ornament. We're going to make a...
Yeah, so we're excited for that. We're going to do, like, these mini books for that one.
How many hours into this book?
So, that is a good question. I don't know exactly. I haven't been, like, clocking hours for it. I probably should have been. So that way I could kind of come up with, like, a better format for how I would price this item. But in all reality, not very long. It doesn't take a terrible amount of time to put a book like this together, but I did a lot of like the steps disjointedly, like the dyeing of the leather and things like that. So, yeah, we're doing ornaments for the challenge too. Like I said, we're going to be doing some mini books. So, we're going to do, we condensed down the Christmas story, and that's what Loretta's working on right now.
It's almost done. I think this is about my third prototype formatting.
Yeah.
So, I'm just going through.
So, yeah, we've been doing, like, several prototypes. I've got one here. It takes a long time just to format a book. So, I know. So, that's why I feel like it's kind of like a loaded question with this one. Like, how many hours went into just this project alone? Probably not very many. but it's all of, like, the stuff that built up for me to be able to put this together. Like, the final, you know, bringing it all together. That took a long time. Just that planning, that prep work stages, I guess. But yeah, but actually putting this book together didn't take very long. And I'm sure like other bookbinders could probably cut like a ton of corners. I know like most other bookbinders don't dye their own leather. And they do like a lot of other stuff like that to kind of cut corners. Amen. I'm formatting 1984 right now. Oh, that's way cool.
That's
awesome. So you're, I guess, yeah, you mentioned earlier that you're a bookbinder.
Yeah.
You do case bindings, you said?
Case bindings, I think. Yeah, I think you popped in on our giveaway stream, Bangin' Robbers.
Like, yeah.
That's where we met you.
That's right.
I kind of
yeah, if you have any pictures too, feel free to drop that into the chat. We'd love to be able to to show that off as well.
Yeah, just enough hours to get it to this point.
Exactly.
I know, I loved your comment on YouTube data. If only we could make a book in 57 seconds. That would be great.
Yeah. So, it's almost like easier for me to like kind of think about this like in terms of days that I put this together. So, if I like had to put another one of these together right now, it would take me probably, I guess, another couple weeks to put together just because of all like the prep work, like I said.
There's just
dry
time.
And there's a lot of dry time. So like we have to set aside an entire day just to marble the paper, right? And it's several days worth just to dye the leather because of the different layers that we do and the dry time that's involved. But like once all of that prep work is done, the leather is pre-dyed, the paper is pre-marbled, then we can bring it together, and if that's all done beforehand, I could probably put this together in 3 days. So.
3 days?
Yeah, if I had like the leather prepared and the marbled.
And you had all day to do it.
And I had all day to do it, I
guess.
Sewing
takes you a long time.
Yeah. But I'm just saying like what my capabilities are, I could easily put this together in 3 days. And I probably wouldn't even need all day. I would need at least a half day for all three of those days, but I don't think I'd need like a full day. But yeah, so there's that. And so like I said, we're working on the formatting for the book. We've had a lot of like hurdles and things to overcome. This is about how big it will be, and as of right now we're still undecided on what type of binding I'm going to do for these, because I want it to be sellable. So I was going to make these not only for the community challenge, but I was going to see if I could make like a couple of them to take to a Christmas market, because I think like these would sell pretty good, like these mini books. So I'm going to try to make like I think 10 of them at a time. So that means whatever binding style I do has to be not take me too much time, so that way I'm not trying to sell this ornament for like $80. we're going to try to keep the cost production to about, what would you say? What would you ideally want to spend on like a small book, like a hand-bound, leather-bound?
That's hard. Book. Because I've seen them sell for like $65, tiny books like this.
That's what I was thinking. I was thinking 50. Like if we could try to keep our budget, you know, for it, 50, then that would be really, really great.
Yeah, no worries, Tatum. We'll see you in a minute.
Yeah. We're really not doing too much after this. This was all I had planned, and it took me significantly less time to get to this point than I thought it would. This was just a butt-naked book beforehand, but yeah, we did all of the dye speckling and the tooling in one go. Aside from the hot tooling, which is something that I'm going to have to experiment with. which I'm not sure if I mentioned that since you guys came in and raided, but I will be hot tooling just like a simple leaf design in the corners there and along the spine as well. And then right here, we're going to put a tag so we can give credit to Mary Shelley for writing the book. But yeah, but for tonight, this is all I had planned. So I can knock out a ring in 20 minutes, but I prefer to take an hour. Otherwise, the pace is not sustainable. And that makes sense.
True.
Yeah, that definitely makes sense too. And for me, I'd much rather get to the point where I could do it in stages so that I'm like bulk making these items. Like I'd much rather have made 10 of these Frankensteins at a time.
10 today.
Exactly. Rather than try and pump out a single book going through all of those stages in one day, I'd rather try and take like one day, go through each of the stages for like for 10 separate books. Because I feel like, yeah, the batch process would be a lot easier on me than trying to rush through all of the steps in one. Yeah, and see, and like my problem is, so this is like the first time again, you know, that I've really felt capable of producing a book like this to this quality. And so I didn't even think to prep for batch work. So this is kind of really more of an experimental process still. Yeah, more efficient too. Hello, Kim for the day. How are you?
Oh, hello.
How's it going? Welcome in. Welcome in. Yeah, we're just chatting here, finishing things up kind of a little bit. So, yeah.
Yeah, I just want to change the margins on these pages. I think they'll look better with smaller margins. Or I guess larger margins. Yeah, I'm increasing the margin size. So it's just taking me a minute because I have to go through and do it manually.
But yeah, so I guess that's the question now that we have. So we're not only preparing to make these little Christmas ornaments here, but we're also preparing to make a Pride and Prejudice book. And so the question now that we have is, now that we've gone through the initial process, we figured out that yes, we can indeed do a French style binding. Should we do that for Pride and Prejudice and make 10 Pride and Prejudice books? And I guess my ultimate question at this point is, can I sell? I know I can make that many of them, but will I be able to take those and sell those? And I don't know. I don't know right now. Economy's been a little rough on some people.
Did I splurge on this knife from Etsy and love it? I'll have to pull that up in just a minute.
See, so I definitely think there's a market out there for this type of like fine bindings and stuff, you know. That does look really nice.
It's like really tiny.
How much is it?
Huh? Yeah, that looks sweet. Reminds me of like all the tiny spatulas and stuff I see YouTube bookbinders use.
Yeah. Gonna go make some dinner, so I'll be lurking. Okay, awesome. Yeah, we'll probably just finish it up here, I think, ourselves. But yeah, so thank you for the raid. I just, you know, it's just too bad that, like I said, we're coming like at the very end. But feel free to follow if you haven't already, because we'll be doing more projects like this very shortly. I do think that doing these mini books will be a very, very fun project to live stream. So yeah, so stick around for that. Do a Necronomicon cover and make it Pride and Prejudice with zombies.
I have seen that book.
There you go. That sounds awesome.
Too bad Halloween's like next week.
Yeah, very true. I know what we need to do is we need to like plan out better to like go to like the bigger shows, because I definitely think if we went to like a Comic-Con or some type of an anime convention and we had like the right stuff in stock, that we could definitely make those sell really well. But we've been mostly hitting like farmers markets, and like, of course, you know, a book like this that I'm going to charge $250 for these ones that are prototypes, but probably more once I get the process a little bit more refined and I can crispen these up a little bit better, then I'd probably charge a little bit more. But most people that are walking around at a farmer's market don't, you know, have that kind of money in their pockets to just walk away with a really nicely bound book. Nobody's going to buy that at a farmer's market. Exactly. No, we bring these to just put up on display to show, like, what I'm capable of. And then people see this price tag, and then they look at my other journals, and they're like, oh, okay, you know, that's not so bad. And we've noticed, actually, that just bringing these along boosts our other sales. It's kind of like the Apple model, right? Where they have, like, their most top-of-the-line stuff that's, like, just extremely expensive. Very few people are going to buy, only if you're, like, a super fan of Apple. And then they have, like, their stuff at, like, the lowest end that just kind of looks, you know, like, who would buy that type of deal? Who wants to go back to having a button on their phone in 2022? So they have, like, their lowest end, right, which is almost, like, kind of laughable. And then that makes it so that right in the middle, everybody just buys everything right there in the middle. They can definitely increase those sales right there because people see it as both a value for their dollar, but a value in terms of, like, the tech that they're getting out of it, the specs that they're getting out of it. And so we're kind of doing the same thing when we bring this along. This is, like, our most top-end thing. And then we have some, like, you know, okay books at, like, our lowest end. But that makes it so that, like, everything in the middle sells a lot better.
So last week, market, I also brought our Harry Potter set for display. People really like to see those.
Yeah, and our Harry Potter set is, we're going to be selling for $2,000. So that's, like, that's probably, like, way more extreme. That starts to make this look like the middle ground.
But that's 7 books.
At right? That's a price. Lot. Yeah. So. There's a lot of work that goes into that. So, yeah. Okay. Well, you want to rate us out?
Sure.
So Rhinus is on. You want to send us over? Let's do Rhinus. Why not? So we're going to rate out. We're going to send you over to Rhinus. Leatherworks.
Okay. Let me know how to
spell
that.
R-I-N-U-S.
R-I-N-U-S.
What's it called? The underscore.
Underscore?
Leatherworks. Yeah, thank you so much for dropping in, Chevy guy. It's been a while. Good to see ya.
Rhinus? Oh, it's not an H.
R-I-N-U-S.
Okay. Yeah. So...
glad I caught some of the stream. Y'all have a good night. And thank you so much for the raid. Tatum, yeah, we'll definitely check out your stuff. Well, I will. Go ahead, hit it, and then they'll kind of do a countdown.
Oh, invalid username. I don't know.
You have to capitalize the L.
Let's try this again.
I don't know if it's case sensitive or not. But yeah, like I said, feel free to follow us because we have a lot of other fun stuff coming along. Yeah, thank you so much
Chevy
for being here.
Chevy recommended to raid ya. Well, thanks, Chevy.
Yeah, thank you so much, Chevy.
Okay, yeah, we've got 15 people. Let's go give Ryan a
stick. Okay, have a good night. Awesome.